Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, if we don't provide our soft power or our humanitarian.
Okay, but see, normally speaking, under CAA, Myanmar is not there, right? Mm-hmm. Myanmar is there?
Mm-hmm.
What are the three countries that are there under CAA? Okay, next time as Sharad does, everybody please raise your hand if you want to answer. So that crowd wisdom will diffuse. Yes? In crowd, everybody is wise. Yes? So, Santosh?
Pakistan, Afghanistan, Bangladesh.
Pakistan, Afghanistan and
Bangladesh.
Bangladesh. So, Myanmar is not there. So, we cannot provide long-term solution also. So, these are the ramifications. And as you know, it gives an opportunity to revise your internal security. India and Myanmar have a border arrangement. What is that called as? How many of you attended internal security classes? So what is that boundary called as, except for Sumant?
Porous
borders. Porous means what? Something which is fluid, right? Which allows movements. Yes. So all Indian borders are porous borders, more or less. So what is the special arrangement between Myanmar and India?
16 kilometer open
border. What is Sharad doing? Yes. Okay. It's called as?
Free movement.
Yes. Free movement regime. That we are trying to modify again. We are not trying to keep it alive. We are trying to modify that also. So when you see a simple article like this, always apply it for international relations. What if we do? What if we don't do? What if tomorrow, if we don't do this and Aung San Suu Kyi comes back into the power? Again, lot of diplomatic capital has to be invested. And again, we cannot keep giving asylum to everybody who approaches India. Yes or no?
But at the risk of democracy, we are running away from a destabilized democracy. So it is more ethically prudent for us to give.
It's a Pandora's box, right? That is why I am saying, Rohingyas, where do they come from? They come from the same country. Yes, they are also refugees. They are religiously prosecuted refugees. These are politically prosecuted refugees. There are climate refugees. People who run away from climate because of the climate change. My house is sinking, my island is sinking. Yes, I am unable to live in that particular area. So all these people are called as climate refugees. And as you know, wars, war-torn areas, Yemen, Syria, Mediterranean, all these areas are again war based refugees. So please look at it from multiple perspectives and develop your thought process. So you get some prelims questions, right? Operation Sunrise, free movement regime. Yes. How many states does India share a border with Myanmar? And also Myanmar is our gateway to ACT East. Apart from that, we have something called as Nagaland issue in today's newspaper, 10th page, I think. Nagaland NSC and IM. Yes, Kaplang, I guess. NSC and K.
IM
only. Yeah. They started renegotiating with Indian government. So it has a lot of ramification. If you can reconnect it to 2.5 front war. Yes or no? The Nagaland issue should not be blown out of proportion. What if India does this and the military gets angry, right? And tries to encourage the rebels in the Naga faction. That is also a problem for India. So whatever India does have a lot of ramifications. So India is hopefully doing the right thing. Clear?
Sir, who will come up with a decision?
Yeah. Ministry of Home Affairs, technically cabinet has to come. Cabinet committee and security or Ministry of Home Affairs, more or less.
Yes.
Because as they sink and swim together, Article 74, right? So if MHA says it's okay, the cabinet should say okay. Or else MHA has to resign or cabinet has to collapse. Yes or no? That is polity again. Yes. Now, Haryana's new job quota. See, that is also main important question, prelims question. Please remember internal security, Myanmar angle. And always remember, whatever domestically or internal matters that happens in your neighbors will always have spillover effects on your nation. Yes? Good article, right? Lot to think upon. Now, yes? Okay. Haryana's new job quota rule worries India Inc. Yes. yesterday there was an article, I may or may not have showed you, but it was there in yesterday's Hindu. So this was yesterday's Hindu, which says reservation in private job, straight body ask Lal government for relook into legislation. So Haryana government has passed a law which says 75% of the jobs are reserved for local population which is less than 50,000 rupees in salary. Okay, so all those jobs which are having less than 50,000 salary can be reserved for locals. Why 50,000 cut? Probably software engineers, service sectors. Gurgaon and all this come under Haryana, right? Gurgaon comes under Haryana only? Yes. Noida comes under Uttar Pradesh. So, lot of employment opportunities there. So, for the rest of the state, local reservation. And this is not the first state or the last state that is going to do. Way back in 1995, Gujarat, the progressive state of Gujarat, has tried to do the same. I think 85% reservation back then. AP passed, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh. So many states are following the suits. So this is a very important mains perspective question. Yes, and your GS paper 3. So what are the ramifications? Is it a good idea or a bad idea?
It's a bad idea because it will stop the movement of skilled
labor force. Okay. Then
Investments also, because it might go to some other area where the
labor force is accepted freely.
Maybe lower in that case. In this case.
So where will you use this article in syllabus terms? Syllabus keyword. Which syllabus keyword actually fits this? Employment, okay. Does regionalism come into the picture? Migration, okay. Interstate development, regional disparities. A lot of things can be linked, right? Okay, so now if everybody does the same, if every state in India passes or plans to pass a similar resolution, what will happen? Unemployment will increase. Demotivation, why?
Because there is reservation in government jobs, so that's why all are going to private. Now again in private sector, if they are providing reservations, it may
But it's not based on socio-economic backwardness, right? It's 75% universal reservation. So if you are from Haryana, if you are skilled enough, you will get a job. It will affect interstate relations. Competitive federalism will be encouraged over cooperative federalism. Very good.
Due to lack of availability of skilled manpower, they may not be able to develop, and in the end, that development force will not enrich India's economy.
So, dream of 5 trillion economy will be hampered. Yes?
But same thing. They might introduce the reservation, but not necessarily all the 75% people will have the same skills required. The upskilling and this thing.
Okay. Yes, you are saying something?
The state which have the industry. But the skilled labor will be from another state.
Another state, so, okay. So, for example, Tamil Nadu, Maharashtra might have industries, or Telangana might have industries, but the skilled labor might be coming from UP, Bihar, or Rajasthan, or some other developing state. So, also, again, it will mostly apply to semi skilled and unskilled labor, right? Because 50,000 salary. Even permanent employees will be of a limited usage, right? Like for example, if I have a big factory, permanent employees will only be 15,000 or 1,000 or something that in that nature. Not everybody will be hired on a permanent basis, right? So there are a lot of ramifications.
Can we say it affect the animal spirits of the private, which is
So the more or less the same point.
It
yes.
Article
19, your ability to go anywhere and work anywhere as you choose. Article 16 and 19 will be violated. So in a sense, you can say it's a violation of constitutional principles. Yes.
Sir, if we allow that, the next step will be to give reservation based on the caste also in private sector.
Okay. So all the jobs are taken by certain community even within that 75% reservation. We need reservation in the socio-economic basis. So that might be the next demand is what she is arguing. Yes. So it might affect the unity and diversity of the nation, right? Like it's a zero-sum game. If every state goes for the same logic, okay, everybody will be having a local protectionism mechanisms. Yes or no? You are not talking about WTO or other kind of protectionisms. You are creating your own local protectionisms. Yes. So local protectionisms are going to hamper the animal spirits again. See, money needs freedom to flow. People, movement, goods and services need to flow freely. That is what globalization is all about. That is how America became great. It never said no to any person, Elon Musk, Einstein, anyone who is coming to India and want to invest knowledge there. It has happily encouraged them to do so. Yes. So America is in a way very great because of the migrants. Yes. So if you don't allow that kind of freedom to flourish, it is going to hamper the long term prospects. Now, two things. Does it actually work at the ground level, or this is more of a political stance? It's more of a populistic measure, and at the ground level, everybody knows it's next to impossible to implement this. You cannot find 75% of the skilled labor only from Haryana, right? Lot of jobs will be lost. You are going to slow down the economy in certain crucial junction rather than empower the economy. Yes or no? Right now, India needs more activity, not unemployment. Right? So these are all the problems that we can see from this particular thing.
If it on the contrary, if you look at it, this will also force the private sector to include in the skill development.
Again, there are two things, right? For example,
long-term effects.
I will go for automation rather than skilling people, right? As an industry, if you force me to push towards, you know, skilling people or invest in their skill development, after a particular point of time, I will prefer to go for automation and mechanization rather than all this drama. Yes or no? Missions doesn't have any state, right?
So, but human capital is the only resource which appreciates over time, right, rather than depreciates.
Definitely. I will always have certain amount. See, if I'm running a Tata company, I'm creating lorries or something like huge scale. I cannot run it without humans, right? There will be certain percentage of humans, human capital, which I will always appreciate and respect, and I will pay them very good salaries. Probably every foreman will get more than 50,000 rupees. Okay. After that, everything is missions. Yes. As Bill Gates once said, you know, you don't even have to give them pensions. When the mission retires, you don't have to give it pensions. No social security, no Ayushman Bharat. Yes or no? So it's a very effective way for a capitalist. Think about all these things. Yes. Yes, Santosh. You can take the example of Kia Motors in Andhra Pradesh. Big companies come and set up shop in particular state. Then you introduce such rules. It may hamper their projections. When I came, I was expecting 20% returns. Now, because of all these things, it might slow down. See, again, there is no empirical data because it doesn't work. From 1995, you can think Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh. So many states have tried to implement this. So if a mains question comes, it's very hard to defend this rather than support this. But as Sharat was pointing out, probably, just maybe probably, it might open the industry eyes and the government eyes to go for rapid skill development. Every state will start investing in the skill development to attract more industries. But as all of us know, skill development is more of certificates rather than actual reality. Yes or no? What is the scheme for skill development in India? Pradhan Mantri Kausal Vikas Yojana, PMKY. Yes, skill developments. OTT platforms will not have to register with the center. See, again, this is a continuous drama. Focus on the original rules. I have shared a PDF, like what exactly government has planned, right? Like the rules which are mentioned in the PIB, read them, read the provisions and get done with it. Because I think this will be like a serial, like it's a, like a Hindi serial. It's going to be 800 episodes or 900 episodes till we come to a conclusion. Okay, so till we come to that conclusion, we can read the introduction and the what happened in the end, who died what, when. Yes, so who will stand in the last is what matters to us, right? So if you go on a daily basis, you have to read, but at the same time you don't have to remember everything or try to remember everything. For example, filthy abuses, okay, are hosted by these platforms are pornographic, right? So these are the arguments that are given by the judiciary. Common sense dictates that I don't need OTT platforms to get access to all those things, and that's a genie which is outside the bottle. Yes or no? You cannot send it back. Yes, and if you go and stand in any good center in Delhi, all you hear is this. Yes, see, that is what society is. OTTs are just reflecting what the society is. It will be innocent for us to believe that OTTs are teaching us something. Probably we are teaching OTTs. Sorry?
We are the content.
Yeah. See, I mean, you get the idea, right? Like, see, I am not saying those things should be encouraged or things should be celebrated. But the thing is, that is creative expression. I cannot imagine Samuel L. Jackson without the F word. Yes or no? Yes? Can you even imagine Samuel L. Jackson without that particular word? I don't know how many of you know Samuel L. Jackson, but if you have ever watched any Hollywood movie, Avengers and all those things, there is a black guy with a bald head. Yes? Nick Fury, yeah. So he is Samuel L. Jackson. Okay, that is a creative form of expression. Yes, I'm not saying that, you know, that should be adapted, but imagine so many movies without certain terms. Okay, degrading women or women based abuses are definitely wrong, but there are certain unisexual or universally accepted words which actually brings out the creative expression. So again, if you don't like it, don't watch it, right? And there are also OTT rules which says you by 18, all of us are adults. If you know who to marry at the age of 18, can't you decide which movie to watch? Yes. So again, this is being very liberalistic. I'm not saying these things should degrade the morals or ethics of the society, but they are a part and parcel of the society. Society only gets vulgar rather than better over a period of time if you try to push it into a corner. Yes. I mean, there is this YouTube star, right? Some Maharashtra guy. He makes music videos. Yashraj something, Mukhate, right? So there was this recently Pari Hai. I will share that YouTube link. Do watch his. He picks up these memes, Big Boss show or something. Some contestant will say some line, right? And he picks that particular line and adds music to it. That is a creative form of expression. Yes, and when you see it, you will appreciate it. Don't worry. Okay, now that is the end of the Haryana case and the OTT. Please remember, yeah, IISc in top 100, a very good thing for India and scientific STEM systems. All of you know, right? What is STEM? Science, technology, engineering, medicine or maths?
Medicine.
Okay. So STEM technologies are to be encouraged. So you will hardly use it in, you know, essay probably, or worst case scenario education. Yes. So IIT Bombay, Delhi and Madras have done better. And one prelims question here is institutions of eminence. What are institutions of eminence? Because India is not performing so well in international rankings, government has designated certain institutions as institutions of eminence. They will be empowered unlike other institutions. Financially and policy wise, they will be given more freedoms. When you are given more freedom, what will happen? You tend to flourish. So that is the plan of the government of India. And IISc is always spearheading the rankings in India. So it's a premier institution for science in country. So probably people's perceptions because of the startups or the changing ecosystems are helping all these things. Once upon a time, if I have to go take my career in science, okay, people may or may not have encouraged, right? Now the mindset of the country is changing. So you can go for PhD at the age of 24, you need not worry about getting married. Yes or no? Many families used to push people, or especially women, to not go for higher education because it is very difficult to find a husband. Yes or no? That is a fact. So all these things are changing. Okay, and government's continuous persistent support to these eminent institutions is also one good thing, right? So try not to read too much into that, just essay. Yes, and there is an article in Hindu, I don't know whether it's in Hyderabad edition. So prelims question, page number 5. Who participated in Dandi March in South India? Just raise your hand. Yes, Santosh. Rajagopalachari. Only Rajagopalachari. Any other famous name? Rajagopalachari only. In Kerala. Who? Again, this is the 2+2+ question. Okay, it's there in Spectrum, it's there in Bipin Chandra. You are supposed to know without second thought. If you are that good, then your first round of prelims is comfortable. So he was a follower of Gandhi, I think. He is a subordinate of Gandhi probably. And I read that book 6 years ago. Not 6 years, sorry, 4 years ago. Okay, so don't worry. So what I am trying to tell you is, please remember, what is the purpose of Dandi March? Why Gandhiji wanted to go for Dandi March? Yes, don't remember the map and all those things. Okay, just remember whether Sabarmati and Dandi. What are the other ashrams that Gandhiji has started in India? Where are they located? Yes, and what did Dandi March achieve? Yes. It is issued by Tourism of Gujarat Board. So for prelims wise, take what is needed, the entire concept of Dandi March. So what is the significance of Dandi March? How many of you know the context or why? Yes, Sharad.
So there was a salt tax implemented by the British.
Idea he wanted to go for connect the people since salt was one of the basic ingredients. He wanted to connect everyone and then show up a civil disobedience against the government. Okay, yes, Rajani, what did it act as? Is it a bridge between two movements, or what is the significance of Dandi March? So it started the civil disobedience movement, or it created the cadre or masses, it made the masses ready for civil disobedience movement in a way. Yes, so connect the dots, it's very easy, right? So if you have time, read it, or else you can go back to your Spectrum and read it. No issues whatsoever. Okay, personally speaking, but keep an eye on the Dandi March. Not so stellar in protecting personal liberty. Good things and bad things about the article is, he is crying over the spilled milk. Yes, and nothing is going to change. Keeping that cynical view aside, we will talk about the possibilities. The three important things he discusses are criminal defamation, sedition, and blasphemy laws. Now, Law Commission report and other commission reports have already clearly mentioned that defamation is here to stay. And sedition is also more or less here to stay, right? The major things. Now coming to blasphemy laws. So what is blasphemy? Blasphemy is saying something bad about the God. Particularly, it's more an Abrahamic concept. The concept of blasphemy comes from Abrahamic religions. You don't technically find the term blasphemy in Indian scriptures. Yes, we don't have the concept of blasphemy. You are more than free to criticize the gods because they have enough power to control you, punish you and reward you. There are many songs, right? For example, if you take Annamaya Kirtana also, okay, he blames Rama because you are, you know, the son of son-in-law of Dasaratha, you are so arrogant. Yes, so in the form of anger also sometimes you can show love. Yes, what is that Annamaya Kirtana? Ramadas, yeah, my bad, Ramadas Kirtana, yeah. Yes, Yavadabba Sommani Kulukutunti Ramachandra, right? So that is something you will never find in many other religions. It's not blasphemy according to our understanding of God. It's he's like a benevolent father. He will understand the reason why I am saying that particular thing in the context I am saying. So the Hinduism or Hindu ethos already had that particular libertarian space, okay, to an extreme level. Now, if you want to get offended, you will always get offended by anything and everything. That is the problematic scenario. And the beauty is, not a single law we are going to discuss is created by the present government, nor they had the need to create them. Most of them are colonial vestiges. So the Victorian ethics or the Victorian morals have flown into Indian constitution and we are continuing the same. Yes, and no? LGBT, according to the Christianity or the Victorian era laws, that time morality criminalized same sex marriages or LGBTs, right? And we continued with the same. So whatever we are practicing is not properly core Indian ethos. And sedition, see, we can blame from Nehru till the present government. Everybody did not do anything about sedition. Yes, it's not about one government, right? It's every government. Okay, now the problem is those laws under normal time will be sleeping, but when I need to target someone, I can always bring them. So you have to understand, per se, having a law itself is a flaw if it is not in sync with the constitutional values. And if somebody is misusing sedition, right? If somebody is misusing sedition laws, it is the responsibility of the judiciary to time and again remind the executive. Conviction rate in sedition cases is hardly less than 2%, right? So that shows you 98% are unnecessarily facing a lot of trauma, then are getting acquitted. But the time that is lost is lost forever. Clear? Yes.
In the article also, this compares it with other modern democracies like this. In most of the modern democracies, these laws are not
removed.
But is India is already in such direction?
Is India heading in that direction?
Is India ready to
head in that Western direction, like that libertarian direction? I think, yes or no? If I am supposed to be labeled as a Hindu or something else, okay, it is how I practice that bring good name or bad name to my religion, not the other way around. Yes or no?
Yes.
Clear? See, I can either promote Daridra Narayana concept, like for example, where I think every human being is Lord or God and I treat them equally, or I can bring in my own understanding and say, you know, don't touch me. I can do both. Yes? Yes. Again, India is technically not totally ready for the radical changes. We will accept that much. Yes. And again, the problem is sedition is always there. It is how frequently you are using it becomes the problem. If you are genuinely using in a genuine case, nobody will have a objection. But every other statement you throw, sedition, then it becomes a problematic issue. But again, as I told you, all these things are already settled issues. So it will take a radical Supreme Court judge or a bench to throw some new light into the discussions. Okay. Clearing a low bar, right? As usual, Hindu is a bit critical of government's actions. Now, the good and the bad. What is the good? Spectrum is a finite resource. It has to be utilized very effectively. So in government's eye, spectrum is a costly resource. So if I sell spectrum, certain bands, right? I need to get more income. And companies are saying, we don't have that kind of financial capacity, right? So we cannot go for down payment. We will only buy what makes us better. Right, we will only take the bandwidths which make us better. Now, is it government's fault to expect more money? Normally speaking, no. Especially in COVID fiscal deficit, it is definitely not true. Is it company's fault not to have more money? They also have their own telecom issues. Yes or no? Losses, disruptive operators, competitive pricing, all those things have brought down revenues drastically. Yes? Now, more and more people have to shift to 5G or 4G. Apart from the urban clutters, more demand should be there. Even if you go to rural areas now, right now, or tier 1 and tier 2 cities, it is not as good as in the cities. Yes? They still don't have the proper broadband connections or 4G connections. They still depend on a decent amount of speeds. So only when as a whole, our ecosystems mature enough to absorb all these kind of revenue sources or generate such kind of revenue sources, companies will be more than willing to purchase the particular bands of spectrum. So think from both the sides. Government side, government is correct. Company side, companies are correct. But there can be a middle path. For example, let's say what Hindu argues is, unrealistic pricing of spectrum, regulatory norms and tax practices tip the sector into a fractious duopoly. Okay. The government has its task cut out. It must now act quickly to ensure that it does not hurt up the very sector. So now, can we say government should allow these companies to use those bandwidths to provide more services which will have spillover effects in the society? For example, if everybody is having access to 4G, a very good speeds of 4G in the country, right, or within the cities, more edutech companies might be created, more startups will be created, or more e-commerce activity might take place, right? Or say for example, 5G. Why 5G is so popular? Because even industrial houses can use 5G's, right? The speed is very good, that latency is very less. Automation will increase because of 5G. So let's say hypothetically, if government allows that 700 megahertz of spectrum and allow these companies to pay as you go model, right? Like not like down payment, pay as you go. You keep using it when you are generating revenues. Okay, you keep paying the taxes. Because of that, side by side, more economic activities also taking place.
Alternatively, maybe we can get the spectrum at a discounted rate.
Instead, it's a permanent loss, right?
No. Instead, ask them to set up, distribute their network from the urban centers to the rural.
Again, what is my incentive there?
You are getting the entire spectrum for very less.
The concept is, if I move to tier 1 and tier 2 cities, there should be some activity to have that spillover effect, right?
Yeah,
Sir, you construct a highway and then
roads will automatically development will happen. Okay.
So I give you 4G speed, then you start watching that.
Definitely. More users will be there. So more I can control. Yes.
So distribute the network, maybe give the entire thing for at a discount.
So that is also one way to look at it, right? Because again, here political ramifications are there. If I give spectrum to certain companies, people might allege me, and there are so many ramifications, right? So if I have to give it to everyone. Yes. And the spillover effects will definitely outweigh the long-term benefits, because this is a bus we cannot miss. 5G is a bus that India cannot afford to miss, where other countries are catching up. If China is going for 5G, USA is going for 5G, we cannot stick back to 4G and expect our ease of doing business or companies to flourish, right? So are more startups to be created. So in all that sense, government should be willing to lose some revenue to gain spillover effects. But again, unfortunately, the problem is, even if I give 5G, I have to do other reforms. Right, ease of doing business, land reforms, labor reforms, so all of them has to come together, and only then this will work out. If I give and if I don't do other reforms, then spillover effects will not happen, right? So the thing is, whether to lose 90,000 crores or 1 lakh crores or 3 lakh crores right now, or allow this and make India a $5 trillion economy to get all that money back in a future date. That is what government should think about. Okay, that should be the takeaway. So it's nobody's fault, at the same time nobody's mistake. We were not ready. With Biden, India may need new template. Now, in 2020 paper, I think there was a question. Diaspora. How do Indian diaspora have implications on foreign policy or domestic policy also? So yesterday also there was an article again. This is an article from yesterday newspaper. I hope you read yesterday's newspaper and noticed that particular article.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So I can move on, right?
Yes,
so if you come back to today's newspaper, this article, if you combine both these articles, in a way you can write that particular mains question. What is that mains question? Anyone remember? How do Indian diaspora have an impact on politics or foreign policy? So this particular article also talks more or less about the same thing. So what is he trying to say? We celebrated when Donald Trump lost. Yes, not all sections, certain sections of the society has celebrated Donald Trump's defeat. So we thought Joe Biden is India's best friend, and there are enough articles in Hindu in recent times which says Donald Trump is still there in spirit in Joe Biden. Yes or no? Nothing is going to change very quickly. Some basic things will change. All the low hanging fruits like Paris Agreement will be, or rejoining UNESCO will be done, but major policy changes won't have a serious impact, right? So that is what we have learned. So in this article, he talks about lot of Indian politicians or Indian origin politicians in US Senate and how they are impacting the foreign policy's narration towards India. So when a senator like the MP of USA, he talks about something related to India, it will have some kind of ramifications, right? And let's say he is also a member of a subcommittee, it will give a lot of power to him. Okay, that is one important point you need to remember. We can celebrate that we have more Indian origin MPs. For example, the Vice President of USA is Indian origin person, like, right? So the ramifications will be very high. If she makes a statement in favor of farmers, let's say hypothetically, she won't, but hypothetically, then it will be a lot of PR management. Yes or no? It's not only no longer diplomatically to be solved, because if a white American, let's say Joe Biden or Obama, made a statement against farmers bill, 99% of Indians won't notice that, right? But if Kamala Harris says something, the next day all the Tamil Nadu media will put it in the front page and it will become a national level news. Yes, not because it is said by Vice President, it is also said by Vice President who has Indian origins. who is supposed to be on our side, right? That is how the normal perceptions work, right? Okay, so they are indirectly trying to bring pressure on India by saying this. Norms of democracy are to be maintained and that protesters are allowed to protest in a peaceful manner with access to internet and journalists. So we can always counter them by saying, you know, the government has already gave full support, they are allowing the freedom. So our own version of the story can also be told. But still there is some kind of perception in US Senate, US Parliament. Okay, why does Britain Parliament and US Parliament has to discuss our issues? As if they don't have their own problems, right? You get, so it's a twin package, right? When you get the good, you'll also get the bad. When you celebrate that, oh, more Indians are there in US Senate, opposite is also equally true. When more Indians are there in in Britain, for example, especially Punjabis, the Sikh brothers, they are in UK. So they have a lot of political capital and also a lot of money power. They are a good lobbying force in UK. So that is why Britain Parliament is forced to go for discussion on Indian farmers bill, right? So that is why government is hell-bent on managing that particular PR issue. So sometimes issues are no longer domestic, they blow up into international level very quickly. The other dimension, the second generation Indian members, okay? You are from India, you are not an Indian. Yes or no? Like she, a teenager in USA right now, is a second generation. Her father went to USA as a software engineer, settled there. He is a first generation migrant. Okay, she is a second generation migrant, or she is actually a US citizen. She is in every sense an American, but looks like an Indian. Yes or no? She's totally American, culture-wise, thought process-wise, logic-wise, every-wise. But she is from India. That is the only commonality she have. Yes? So that is the most biggest problem that we are going to face. The cultural roots are somehow removed. Yes or no? Just because you wear kurta and celebrate Diwali and White House doesn't make you India, right? Indian. You are Indian when you have that feeling. You will be oppressed. You will have that emotional attachment with your motherland, because you are born in India for 20-25 years. You grew up here. You went to IIT. You studied on government's money to an extent. Then you went to USA. Yes, that bond with India will always be there. But from day one, you are born and brought up in America. You have no clue whatsoever what India is. Yes or no? I hope you understand. So it's very difficult to convince such people, because they will be totally convinced based on the perception of the Western media. Clear? So diasporas, people will still keep moving to Western countries from India, right? Patriotic Indians will always be going to other countries to settle. That will always be there. But you cannot expect the same thing. Okay. Now, how do we manage this? Again, more and more PR, yes or no, have some summits, meetings. There should be a proper connect between Indians from India and the outside India. Like what is the January 9th, Pravas Bharatiya Divas. We celebrate Pravas Bharatiya Divas on January 9th. Why? Good. Yes. Gandhi returned to India on January 9th. Okay, the most famous Pravasi. Yes or no? So he came back to India from South Africa after decades on January 9th. That is why every year on January 9th, Indian government celebrates Bharatiya Pravas Divas. So it brings the diasporas together, summits, meetings, and also a lot of business activities, right? So it's the synergies will be created. Okay, next. So whatever goodwill we still have in the Western countries or Western diaspora, we should try to maximize it and we should make most out of it. That should be the right lessons. So that is why government has merged the PIO and OIC cards, right, to make life easier for the NRIs. E-postal voting probably will be allowed for NRIs, ballot, e-ballots. So they can vote from abroad. So that will keep the connections strengthened. Yes? Okay. And single proprietor companies, etc., which can be encouraged, which are encouraged in the budget, will also encourage the NRIs to come back and set up shop in India. So the more you allow them to have that connection, the more connected they will be. So instead of treating them as an outsiders, it's our responsibility to make them as comfortable as possible and grow in such a fashion that they feel that we should go back to India. Yes or no? Good for writing. Yes. Okay. And prelims wise question, S-400 missile system is Russian missile system. What is the similar missile system of USA? They are like air surface attack missiles. Yes, very good. THAAD missile system. THAAD. THAAD is a similar system of USA. So USA is not happy that we are purchasing that, and we are purchasing S-400 missile system. So it is a previous prelims question. S-400 is from which country? Russia. So all the trivial data like spike missile is from, this torpedo is from. So they might be useful. Okay. So also CATS, the countering American adversaries through sanctions act. So that is one more act, important act for USA, from USA. But India got an exemption from CATS because of our diplomatic abilities. Clear? This we have discussed. Ending the war in Yemen. The most important reason being humanitarian crisis or humanitarian grounds. So it's a proxy war between Saudis and the Iranians, or with USA's support. Yes. So Saudis persuaded USA to support the attack on Yemen, right? So recently Joe Biden also allowed an attack in Syria. So when big countries play in small countries, it is the local population that will severely face the brunt. Okay, so there is no prelims question in this particular article. More or less Yemen map pointing wise, where is Yemen, north or south of Saudi Arabia, on the border of which sea, yes, and what are the surrounding nations, okay, and the rebel groups, for example, Hezbollah is where, Houthis are where, Uyghurs are where, Rohingyas are where, all these are also basic prelims questions. Yemen is famous for Houthis, yes. Not famous, like Yemen have Houthis. Okay, so this article is more of map pointing wise, very useful. Clear? Honor killing. So despite protection of the Supreme Court, so Supreme Court or High Court, they have provided protection for her. The High Court, yeah. The High Court has protected, provided protection for her. In spite of that, the father killed the daughter because she eloped with some person of a different community. So casteism is still very strongly prevalent in the country, and this is more or less a sad state of affairs. Clear? So just remember, we are not totally there. Protection and all those things, they need lot of resources. Don't you think so? So the simple arguments will be, why should they run away? Why can't they marry the person the parents show? Yes? That is one way to look at the article. The other way is, why can't you celebrate independence? Why can't you celebrate individuality. Let her decide what is good or bad for her. Yes. Okay. Next, coming to this article, that is a honor killing article, just remember that much. We are still far away from casteism. If somebody says, you know, India is moving away from caste, we can always go back to the roots. Supreme Court squashes notification by Maharashtra Election Commission. Reservation should not exceed 50%. In 1992 Indira Swane case, 2006 M. Nagaraju case also, Supreme Court has multiple times reiterated the cap should be 50%. But that is not the kicker in this particular article. As all of you know, 27% of reservation is there for other backward classes. Yes. So combinedly, SC, ST plus OBC should not cross 50% of the reservation. That is point number one. The other thing is the last paragraph. The top court clarified that OBC members who benefited from this reservation would be deemed to have vacated their seats under Article 142. So that is a very important thing. Why? A law has been passed, more than 50% reservation is applied, and certain people came into the system because of that extra reservation. Let's imagine 100 members are elected for panchayati. Okay, 55 members are now elected from reserved communities. Right, the top 5% extra 5 people who are there, who got into the system because of the extended OBC reservation. Right, you get the concept? See, 27 people should be from OBC, 8 people from ST, or 16 or 17 from SC communities. That is the reservation system, right? So 16 people came from SC community, 10 people came from ST community, like what, 26, right? 25 people, let's say 25 people came from these two communities, and 32 people came from OBC community. So normally how many people should have come from OBC community? Only 27%, right, maximum. So all those 5 or 6 people who came into the election system or who got elected because of OBC reservation, the extra top 5, they will be automatically assumed to be removed. That means Supreme Court in one stroke nullified the entire elections. Okay, and that is extraordinary power that the Supreme Court has taken under Article 142. Normally what would happen if, say, Shweta here has been elected, okay, she has to resign. Yes, or she has to, you know, I have to use the Representation of People's Act or some other act, panchayatis, some act of that particular state to say she is disqualified. Okay, Supreme Court has outrightly said all those people who got elected are outrightly removed overnight. Okay, it cancels the entire election process. That is truly extraordinary power. No, only those people who got into the system. Let's say simple, I will tell you. These 3 seats are there. These 3 seats are OBC seats. Okay. This is the extra seat. In old reservation system also, or in before this particular amendment, only these 3 seats existed. Because of the amendment, I created an extra seat. And you were elected in this particular seat. So only you will be cancelled. Because because all these 3 are already there, right? Before the amendment. See, this is a new amendment, right? You understood the simple logic? See, there are 20 people in this room. Earlier also. From this moment onwards, 21st person came. So I cancelled this moment. What happened? The last person who came is deleted from the system. Yes or no? See, don't try to complicate it. Very simple process. Just before 2020, there are 3 seats. 2021, 4 seats. Supreme Court cancelled the 2021 seat. That means the 4th seat is automatically removed. He doesn't exist. But the concept here is 142. Just yesterday, I think we were discussing, right? Extraordinary powers of Supreme Court. How extraordinary? To the extent it has nullified the voice of the people. Like, he has been elected, right? Yes, and removed. And it is Supreme Court's power. It's in the right way. because you created something out of nothing, and you cannot say it is legitimate because people elected him. It will have ramifications. Clear? So very important article. Last article of the day. India wants last few articles, I guess. India wants Chabahar port on the key corridor. International North-South Transport Corridor is important for prelims, map pointing wise also. It is a corridor. Corridors means what? Air, land and water transport. All the three will be included in this particular zone from Russia till India. So here is India, Russia. So the entire zone, the entire area will be called as corridor. Now India wants Chabahar port to be included in that particular thing. Let's say this is Mumbai, this is Russia. This entire countries, this entire zone will be international north-south transport corridor. Okay, why Chabahar port? Chabahar port is somewhere here. So Chabahar port will be on the route, and also it will provide more access to India. Right, yeah, Afghanistan. So what happens because of these corridors? More economic activities will take place, more spillover effects will take place, and most importantly, cost of logistics will come down. What is cost of logistics? I have to move certain tons of goods from Mumbai to some other country. If there is a good established corridor with low tariff barriers, with agreed route, I can plan properly and cost will reduce. So it's a good thing for India. Exports will increase, imports will become cheaper. Yes, our connection to the Central Asian countries will also thrive. Right? So similarly, we can go for pipelines, right? Tapi pipeline is there. Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan and India. So Tapi pipeline and other pipelines are also there. So just remember the importance of Chabahar port, map pointing wise, Chabahar, Gwadar. Chabahar is also very closer to Strait of Hormuz. Yes. Clear? So map pointing wise also keep an eye on Chabahar port. In the end, anyhow, when you do current affairs, you'll come go through all these things. But today, if you just plan in the mind, okay, one day I have to relook at Chabahar port, Gwadar port, Strait of Hormuz, right? Then connection to Afghanistan. It will become very easier. And what are the steps taken by Indian government to promote trade? You can also write in such articles. Yes. Fuel prices to drop if brought under GST. It will have implications on fiscal federalism. As all of you know, fuel or petroleum rates are one of the important for the state governments. So the prelims question here is, what are left to the state governments after GST's implementation? Yes? How many of you know the answer? Very good. Yes, Shweta?
Alcohol, petrol, and land revenues.
Land revenues, stamp duties. Aviation turbine fuel, diesel, alcohol for human consumption, always remember that. Spirits, alcohol for human consumption. Petroleum. So what will happen if petroleum is also moved into GST? Do you think states are that innocent? Is it a good idea? If states give up that power also, I don't think how they should be called as states. Yes, natural gas is also outside GST. Yes, natural gas is also outside GST. You can bring in natural gas probably under GST, but petroleum, long-term ramifications. What if COVID, something like COVID happens again in 2030 and states don't have any revenue source? Yes. So other prelims questions, clear? So what are covered under GST? Okay. a very important question as well. Right. So I think we can end the class here. So for just yesterday we were discussing, right, foreign direct investment flow into the country, bilateral investment treaty. At that time I told you, so we have around 60 to 70 billion or 70 billion dollars of foreign direct investment. So we should take it to anywhere between 200 to 300 billion dollars. So that will be a huge, fantastic amount of money. Yes. So focus on prelims as usual, as I told you, right? So in the newspaper also we will try to focus more on prelims. If it's something really worth it, I will anyhow collect on the facts for weekend weekly update, right? Yes. So don't just write down and forget it. If you do every day's work on that particular day, hardly it will take 30 minutes. After that you are totally free. But if you postpone, sir, in the last I will look at the map, okay, you won't recollect in the exam. Daily 5 minutes dose of Atlas is much better. Yes, daily 5 minutes dose of Atlas is much better than last day 1 hour batting. It doesn't work. Okay. Yes. Okay, then thank you, see you all tomorrow.